नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स। नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स। नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स। साधु साधु। सो टुडे सिस्टर खेमा कुड नॉट जॉइन बिकॉज शी वॉज टायर्ड। शी वॉज ऑन ए प्रोग्राम टुडे। So we will go ahead with the sutta which I found interesting. Normally, dependent origination starts with ignorance, and sometimes they start with contact also, or sometimes it is started with consciousness and mentality, materiality. So this is sometimes considered that ignorance is the start point of everything, and that is not the correct kind of understanding, as we'll see from the sutta. So I'll read the sutta, and then I'll kind of give pointers as we go along with the reading of the sutta. So I'll start with the sutta, which is Avijja Sutta. So it's the name of the sutta itself is Avijja, that is ignorance. And I have shared you a link on the WhatsApp of the sutta, and I'll share a link over here also, which I am referring to. So you can kind of follow with me while reading the sutta. So the sutta begins as Bhikkhu, this is said. A first point of ignorance, Bhikkhu, is not seen into being. Still, ignorance is seen to have a specific condition. Ignorance is not the starting point. It also has a condition. And I say because that ignorance has a nutriment. It is not without a nutriment. And what is the nutriment for ignorance? It should be said the five hindrances. The five hindrances is the nutriment for the ignorance. The five hindrances, as we know, is sensual desire, ill will, sloth and torpor, restlessness and worry, and doubt. Now this doubt is specifically for the doubt in the teach the path. It is not a general doubt like should I have a vanilla ice cream or a chocolate ice cream. That is also a kind of doubt which a person has. But when we are referring to doubt, this doubt is specific to the path and the practice of the Dhamma. So you have doubt when you are practicing, am I doing the correct thing? Is this the correct path I am on? Should I shiksar, or is the shiksar which I am doing, is this the correct way? Those are the kind of doubts a person can have. So that is a part of the hindrances. Sensual desire is any desire which is linked to the five senses. That is eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body. Even any kind of a thinking, that is sixth sense also you can say is the mind. So any mind objects like thinking about a certain thing. Some have a habit of overthinking. Ill will is self-evident, sloth and torpor, restlessness and worry. So those kind of things come in real life also, and it are more prominent in when we are doing the meditation. Those hindrances are kind of visible. So what the Buddha is saying is that the nutriment for ignorance is the five hindrances. The five hindrances also has a nutriment. And what is the nutriment for the five hindrances? The three kinds of misconduct. What are the three kinds of misconduct? Three kinds of misconduct is, one is the misconduct by thought, by the mind. and any kind of thoughts of ill will or thoughts of greed. Those are the misconducts of the mind. What are, then there are misconducts of the speech, lying, then you gossip, idle chatter, that is. Then it is any kind of talk which you do with the another person to makes two groups fight, and lying. So those are the kind of verbal misconducts. Then bodily misconducts, you hit somebody or you kind of do any kind of stealing, killing. Those are the kinds of bodily misconducts. So those are the misconducts which are responsible. That is the reason Bhante says that hindrances have your past actions, your past karmas as the source. So if you are feeling a certain kinds of hindrances in meditation, you can kind of, over here we are getting a kind of a confirmation that they indeed come as a result of your actions. And those are the three kinds of actions: mental, verbal, and physical actions. I say that three kinds of misconduct too, I say, have a nutriment. They are not without nutriment. And what is the nutriment for the three kinds of misconduct? It should be said, non-restraint of the sense faculties. Non-restraint is you are not putting any kind of limitations on your senses. So if you want to watch something, you watch. If you want to eat something, you eat. If you want to go somewhere, you go. So there are no kinds of limitations you are putting on your senses. That is, restraint is not good. So what we start in meditation is that the first thing which we do is we put a restraint on our senses. We say we close our eyes, we keep our attention on an object of meditation. So that is the start of the three kinds of misconduct. If you are not restrained, then those misconducts can happen. And it is not so a non-restraint of senses too is is not without nutriment. And what is the nutriment for non-restraint of sense faculty? It should be said, lack of mindfulness and clear comprehension. So mindfulness, as we say, if you don't have mindfulness, then you will have no sense restraint. And what is mindfulness according to Bhante? Bhante says that mindfulness is observing the mind's attention, how mind's attention moves, movement to movement, in order to see clearly and precisely how the impersonal process of dependent origination occurs. So what we are doing is in mindfulness is that we are saying that you have to remember to observe how your mind is moving from movement to movement. And how we do it is being aware, being aware of what is happening. So when you are sitting in meditation or we are in our daily life, we know what our thoughts are doing. Even if you are watching something, or even if you are working on a computer, you watch your mind and be aware that how your mind has attention has gone from what you are doing currently to something else. And how this is an impersonal process, and how it is because of that, dependent origination becomes an important study for us. So that is also important. So we see that that non-restraint has nutriment as lack of mindfulness and clear comprehension. Lack of mindfulness and clear comprehension too, I say, has a nutriment. It is not without a nutriment. And what is the nutriment for lack of mindfulness and clear comprehension? It should be said, careless attention. Careless attention too, I say, has a nutriment. So careless attention means that you're not careful where you are putting your attention. As Bhante explains, Bhante Vivekananda does explain that what is the food for the hindrances? The food for the hindrances is your attention. So the more you put your attention on certain things, that thing will grow. So when a hindrance comes, what is the first instruction which we are given? First is you recognize that the hindrance is, my attention is there on the hindrance. Then you let it be. So recognize and release. Release your attention. And then you relax and re-smile and bring back your attention to your object of meditation, return. So that is how you are putting your attention on the correct thing, which is whatever is your task in your daily life or your meditation object while you are sitting. So that is where we see that the careless attention leads to lack of mindfulness, which leads to the non-restraint of senses. So Buddha is saying that careless attention too, I say, has a nutriment. It is not without a nutriment. And what is the nutriment of careless attention? It should be said lack of faith. Lack of faith is lack of faith in the, there are different explanation given. The lack of faith in the Buddha means not as a person, not Gautama Buddha as a person, but Buddha is in the faith in the possibility of awakening, the possibility of release from this samsaric cycle. So that is the faith which we have. And the second aspect of this faith is the faith in the causal relationship of the universe or the samsara. The samsara is a causal relationship. If this happens, that comes to be. If this arises, that arises. If this does not come, that does not come to be. If this does not arise, that does not arise. So it's a causal relationship of the world. So you have to have the faith in that aspect of the teaching and the aspect of Buddha, which is the awakened. Awakened state as to be achieved by oneself. If Buddha has awakened, he has awakened with his own efforts and he gives us a path to walk. So he has simplified the process for us. That's the reason we have to have the faith in that process itself. So lack of faith, I say, has a nutriment, and it is not without a nutriment. And what is a nutriment for lack of faith? It should be said, not hearing the good Dhamma. So here we come again and we understand that hearing the good Dhamma will lead to faith. So not hearing the good Dhamma is the nutriment for the careless, so lack of faith. So not hearing the good Dhamma, I say, has a nutriment. It is not without a nutriment. What is the nutriment? Not associating with good people. So not associating with good people means that you are not associating with people who are of the faith, of who have knowledge, or who have the understanding of the Dhamma. So when you are getting in touch with people who are knowledgeable, who have a good conduct, who have good knowledge of the Dhamma, then you have an opportunity to hear the good Dhamma. And when you are hearing the good Dhamma, then you will kind of develop faith. And what is the nutriment for not hearing the good Dhamma? It should be said, not associating with good persons. Thus, not associating with good persons becomes full, fills up not hearing good Dhamma. Not hearing the good Dhamma fulfills lack of faith. Lack of faith fulfills careless attention. Careless attention fulfills lack of mindfulness and clear comprehension. Lack of mindfulness and clear comprehension becoming full fills up non-restraint of the sense faculties. Non-restraint of the sense faculty becoming full fills up the three kinds of misconduct. The three kinds of misconduct becoming full fill up the five hindrances. Five hindrances becoming full fill up ignorance. Thus, there is nutriment for ignorance, and in this way, it becomes full. So as we have seen that ignorance has nutriment. There is a cause for the ignorance to arise, but there is also a virtuous cycle. So Buddha is now going to explain to us the virtuous cycle, how it can go towards the fulfillment of the Nibbana. So he gives us a simile over here, which I will just browse over. I'm not going to read the whole simile. Just as when it is raining and the rain pours down in thick droplets on the mountain top, the water flows down the slope and fills up the clefts. So it is saying that when rain is falling, it fills up the small kinds of gaps in the mountain. That gaps becoming filled fills up small kind of rivulets. Small kind of rivulets getting filled up, it fills up small rivers. Those small rivers filling up, fills up the bigger river, and then it ends up in the ocean. So it is a kind of a simile. It is giving us a kind of a visual image of how it works, how one thing leads to another, a cause and condition cycle. I say because thus true knowledge and liberations has a nutriment. They are not without nutriment. And what is the nutriment for true knowledge and liberation? It should be said, seven factors of enlightenment. The seven factors of enlightenment too, I say, has a nutriment. So true knowledge and liberation is the Nibbana. The true knowledge, and that leads to the liberation. So true knowledge and liberation is the Nibbana. So Nibbana has a cause and condition, and that is the seven factors of enlightenment. It starts with mindfulness, then energy, investigation, energy, then joy, then tranquility, then concentration, and in the end, equanimity. So that is how seven factors of enlightenment works. In seven factors of enlightenment also, the Buddha is giving us the same in another sutta. Buddha is explaining that how one thing leads to another. Buddha is saying that, say, if you have mindfulness, then the investigation kind of becomes possible. If you are investigating with mindfulness, then you are able to generate energy. When you are generating energy, then joy arises. When joy arises, tranquility is there. When tranquility is there, then you have collectedness. When you have a collectedness, then you can reach equanimity. So in this way, one thing leads to another. So while we were explaining the eightfold path also, in the same way, one thing is leading to another and reaching its fulfillment. So seven factors of enlightenment too, I say, has a nutriment. They are not without nutriment. And what is the nutriment for the seven factors of enlightenment? It should be said, the four establishments of mindfulness. So four establishments of mindfulness are the nutriment for seven factors. The four establishments of mindfulness is body, feeling, mind, and mind objects, that is thoughts. So this also can be thought as a kind of one thing leading to another. Say if you have attention on your body, then it becomes easier to get your attention on the feeling. When you have attention on the feeling, after feeling, what happens? There is a craving. So craving happens in the mind. So you are become aware of the mind. After craving, what happens is clinging. All the thoughts of why you like the object or not. So the thinking process starts. So that is also, you can check. So that is also a progressive way of investigation. So if your investigation, your attention is on the body, then it becomes easier to put your attention on the feeling. when you have attention in a feeling, it becomes easier to put attention on the mind. When you have good attention on the mind, then you have understanding of the mind objects. So this is the nutriment for the four establishment for the seven enlightenment factors. And what is the nutriment for the four enlightenment four establishments of mindfulness? It should be said the three kinds of good conduct. The three kinds of good conducts are the mental good conduct, verbal good conduct, and physical good conduct. So those are the three kinds of good conduct. When you do, they become nutriment for the core establishment of mindfulness. And what is the nutriment for the three kinds of good conduct? It should be said restraint of sense faculties. When you are restraining your sense faculties, as in meditation or as in a day-to-day life, when you are not kind of becoming a slave to the senses, that is the eyes, hearing, smell or taste or tactile feelings or mind objects or thoughts. Those, if you are restraining, that becomes a nutriment for the good conduct, the good action in your life. So what is the nutriment for sense restraint of the sense faculty? It should be said that mindfulness and clear comprehension. So if you have mindfulness and clear comprehension, then you will be able to restrain the sense faculties. And what is the nutriment for mindfulness and clear comprehension? It should be said careful attention. When you are putting your attention correctly on an object of meditation and keeping it on the object, six-hour-ing and coming back, that is nutriment for having a good mindfulness. And what is the nutriment for careful attention? It should be said faith. If you have faith, then you will be able to have a careful attention. And what is the nutriment for faith? Hearing the good Dhamma. Hearing the good Dhamma, I say, has a nutriment. It is not without nutriment. And what is the nutriment for hearing the good Dhamma? It should be said associating with good persons. So thus, associating with good persons becomes full. It fulfills the hearing of good Dhamma. When you hear the good Dhamma, then you have, you develop faith. When you develop faith, you can develop your careful attention. When your careful attention develops, then mindfulness and clear comprehension develops. When mindfulness and clear comprehension is developed, then you can develop your restraint of the sense faculties. When you develop the restraint of the sense faculties, then you can develop three kinds of good conduct. When the three kinds of good conduct is developed, then you can develop the four establishments of mindfulness. When you are establishing the four kinds of mindfulness, then you can fulfill the seven factors of enlightenment. There is a kind of a message coming for the internet instability. The seven factors of enlightenment becoming full, you fills up the true knowledge and liberation. Thus, there is nutriment for true knowledge and liberation, and in this way, they become full. So, as you can see that every kind of an action has a nutriment, and that nutriment fulfills the another part of the practice. So even ignorance has a nutriment, and even liberation has a nutriment. In this way, the Sutta is giving a another process or a deeper understanding of the dependent origination. And there is also one other option, means there is another way of explaining the dependent origination in another way. This is from the book, this is available online. This is Dependent Origination by P.A. Poyuttam. It is available online as a PDF. So this book also you can refer, but it is a book I would say that we don't, or I personally don't fully agree, but there are many good points, and those points are kind of useful. So you can maybe refer to that. There is another path which is been given in this in regards to the reaching of Nibbana, which is taking into account the dependent origination and how it works. This can start with faith, virtuous conduct, or wise consideration. So wise consideration is somebody who wants to investigate this any kind of practice. So he has no faith in it, but he says that I'll put all my effort in a wise manner, and based on that he kind of progresses. So there is virtual conduct, there is virtuous conduct. Virtuous conduct is Shila, and then there is faith. You can start with faith or virtuous conduct, and that also can lead you towards Nibbana. How it is explained, we will kind of go through once over here. So this is about virtuous conduct. So virtuous conduct leads to non-remorse, and non-remorse leads to joy. Joy leads to delight. Delight is, I think, pasaddi. I think one second. Delight is pamoja. Sometimes joy is used as piti, and sometimes delight is so for pamoja it is delight. So it leads to joy, pamoja, that is it leads to here it has been it is a kind of a base. Basically the words which are used can be interchanged. So I'll go through this translation, and I'll be true to this translation of this book. So virtue leads to non-remorse. Non-remorse leads to joy. Joy leads to delight. Delight leads to tranquility. Tranquility leads to happiness, sukha. Sukha leads to collectedness. Collected needs to leads to knowledge and vision of things as they really are. Yatha bhuta jnana darsana, and this leads to disenchantment, and disenchantment leads to dispassion. Dispassion leads to knowledge and vision of liberation. So this is the cycle of ending the cycle of samsara. So now the other starting point we have taken is wise consideration. When we start with wise consideration, that leads to joy, that leads to delight, that leads to tranquility, that leads to happiness, that leads to collectedness, that leads to knowledge and vision according to reality, that leads to disenchantment, that leads to dispassion, and that leads to liberation. So we start with skillful conduct, faith, and wise reflection, and we go to joy, delight, tranquility, happiness, concentration, that is collectedness, knowledge and vision, disenchantment, dispassion, liberation, and destruction of mental defilements. So these are the ways which the dependent origination or the process of Nibbana are explained in a multiple ways. So I'm kind of really quick with this thing. It is 30 minutes, I think 29 minutes. So now, is there any questions regarding this sutta or any other questions? First, we'll start with any questions about the sutta, and what has been explained in the sutta. If that is clear, then it will help people. Yes. Yes, you.
Actually, the sutta name itself is moha.
Avita ignorance. It is called ignorance.
Ignorance sutta.
Yeah, Avita sutta.
Why it is silent about the other two doshas? That is lobha moha, lobha and dosha. That is greed and hatred. When those two are playing with the person, immediately the ignorance comes.
Correct.
But it is silent. The sutta is silent about it. First of all, these two root causes create the moha.
So see, lobha, moha, dosa are the defilements. Okay. So they are the starting point of all kind of actions which are unwholesome. Okay.
Wholesome, so maybe unwholesome.
Action. Yeah.
Maybe.
So
even wholesome will not have will maybe having the ignorance also.
Yeah, but in our sense, we say wholesome would be any action which is leading us to Nibbana, leading us to liberation. Okay? Wholesome is not merit based. If you are earning merits, in itself, it is not a kind of a higher practice. Abhidhamma, which is said by the Buddha, is the higher practice. Higher practice is, or higher knowledge is, for the destruction of defilements and leading us to Nibbana. That is what Buddha's teaching is. He teaches about dukkha and the end of dukkha. So that is, in short, the path. So if when we are saying you are doing something wholesome, we are going towards the dispassion and disenchantment and liberation. So over here, the sutta's name is ignorance. So it is saying that what is the cause and condition for ignorance to arise. So that is how it is explained.
Okay. Sadhu,
sadhu. Yes, you.
Just picking up on that point, I came in a little bit late on the sort of reading. So I missed your explanation of the three kinds of misconduct. Could you repeat that for me?
Three kinds of misconduct is very simple. One is the mental thoughts. Then verbal and bodily actions.
Okay, so these are like the three sankharas, the independent origination.
Yes, so what happens is that it can start with a mind, which say if you have ill will, and if you have ill will of towards somebody, or anger comes up in your mind. Then mm-hmm. what would happen is it would lead to angry words. Mm-hmm. What happens is when you are angry and you are using angry words, it may lead to kind of fits and blows.
Yes.
So that is how it is also hierarchical, but it can be independent also. That there is something you like, okay? And you take it. So there is an action by bodily. There is no verbal, but everything has to start with a thought. Without a thought, there cannot be a verbal misconduct or a this thing. But only in thought, if you have this thing, if you have ill will towards somebody, and you just keep it in yourself, that itself can lead to very bad results. In one of the suttas, Buddha is explaining because that was important because. In Vinaya, monks have never kind of admonished or there is no offense for thought-based misconduct. Okay? So I kind of initially thought that thoughts were not kind of important. But then I read a sutta where Buddha is saying that if you have ill-will thoughts of ill-will or any kind of a negative thoughts about other, that can yep. kind of lead to your bad results in your future life also. So that is important. So if you can just have the thoughts, that is the reason in the opposite reverse side, metta and your feeling of metta is kind of has a great benefit, but you are not saying anything, nor doing anything by physically. Eventually a person who has a mind of metta will say good words, kind words, and will have act kindly and will be helpful, but only by this. Okay.
So if someone finds that they're having challenging thoughts for themselves, which they find perhaps even distressing for themselves, what's the best way for them to work with that? Is that to then encourage them to bring up metta in that circumstance?
Yes. So that is what Rahula Sutta is about. While they say that if you have ill will towards somebody, then you do metta. If you are kind of jealous of somebody, then you do karuna. Then if you sorry metta karuna upekha upekha then you do the practice of I am just getting a little bit confused, but because of my mind works in this way, so that is how you kind of do the opposite of that. Say if okay. you are ill will, you are doing metta. So that is how you are working with that. So you are, then 6 hours is very important, and not taking things personally. So if a thought is coming up, you are not taking it personally. You understand that the thought was not there. It thought has come up and it shall go away.
So bringing up the opposite. And how do you ensure that when you bring up the opposite, it's actually genuine?
So okay. That is what Buddha is saying, that it is not some whatever you bring up is genuine, because that is there in your mind, and what is there nutriment is your attention. So even okay. if it is a seed and you are keeping it, giving it nutriment, it will go into a big plant. So when you start out with metta, you may not feel that the metta feeling is not much. But if you keep giving it a nutriment, that is your attention, then it will grow. So that is how you kind of don't go into the, it is genuine, because everything where your attention is there, that is genuine.
Okay. Thank you very much, Bandi.
Even if it is very small. It is, yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Any other question? So anybody else has a question? I am sure everybody has understood the sutta in detail, but if you have a clarification or something like that, it would kind of help you, and it will also help others. Any other question, any other related to meditation or any other points of Dhamma, anybody has a question? Okay. Yes.
I have another question. In the second reading, you went from joy, delight, tranquility, happiness, collectedness, knowledge of things as they envision, disenchantment, dispassion, and then I think you mentioned knowledge and vision, and then liberation. So, what is that second knowledge and vision compared to the first knowledge and vision?
See, there is knowledge and vision is the knowledge and vision how things are happening. Okay, so like when you are in the state of meditation, you come to know certain things, that how this is impersonal, how this thought was not there but just came up, and even if and how it goes away on its own. So all those things, when you are kind of getting the say practical in your activities or in your meditation, when you are getting this kind of knowledge, when it accumulates, then there is a disenchantment. So disenchantment is that a little bit distance, you will feel that there is a distance between you and the activities. Like there is a food you like, say an ice cream or a pudding you like, and you have that pudding. There will be kind of a distance between that taste and taking it personally, which was there before. So that you may still taste the taste very kind of clearly, but you will not have that kind of an attachment. So that is a kind of a distance between that thing and the feeling.
Okay.
This passion is when you may see it and you may not even want it to have it. Previously, if you always saw that pudding or a cake or a ice cream or some other thing. In India, people like fried things more than sweets, you know. So those kind of things, you know, then you may have that in your table, but you may not want to even eat it, you know. It is there, so it's okay. So that kind of there is a more distance.
Okay, and sometimes these words are translated as revulsion. But I find disenchantment and dispassion much more helpful in the practice than the idea of revulsion.
Correct. So there are certain words, how they are translated depends on the translator also. Mm. And how he is kind of being guided, or how his own perceptions work. So revulsion is not a thing which is healthy, you know. But when you are having a dispassion, then the level of attachment is like you have you are distancing yourself from the passions.
For me, revulsion has energy in it. Whereas dispassion has the energy taking out of it.
Correct. Yes, very good. Yeah, that is the right kind of frame of reference.
Okay. Thank you very much, Bhante.
Thank you. So I am going to end this early because anyways, Sister Khema has a lot of stories and everything to share. But currently, I can just share that Delson is there in Dhammasukha, so you can send questions or anything which you have for him, because he has been very kind of proactive in answering the questions and replying to any questions people have. And he will be giving talks for the next 2 weeks or something like that. So he will have a chance to respond. So you can send it to him. So that is one good thing. And Bhante stock is also kind of put, a new talk of Bhante has been put up on this thing, schedule. So that will stream. So we are having a lot of things happening. And over here also, we will be having a few things happen, like the retreats may start. As of now, if I get a chance to, I can travel, if I get a chance to India, if there is a retreat or something like that, based on situation over here, those are things are happening. So there are positive things. So is there any other person who has a question or anything? Alex?
I'm sorry, Bhante. I couldn't quite hear what you just last said. The sound broke up for me. Did you say that yourself and Sister Khema will be running some online retreats?
Online retreats, no, but we may have physical retreats, because we have we are in a negotiation with somebody for a meditation center to be rented out to us. So it may be rented out not as a kind of a commercial viewpoint, but they may just take a nominal amount to rent out the place to us, and non-exclusive, we will do the retreats, they will also do their retreats.
Okay. So and I have one more question. To send a donation, is it the same thing as we've done in the past to your PayPal?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
No. Wise.
The wise. That's right. Wise. The wising. Yeah. Okay. So, thank you.
That will be there for some time. But for India, we will be opening an account because for our trust has been formed formally. It is active from last March, but we have not got the trust certificate. So when we get the trust certificate, we can have open an account, and for India, it will change. And we will take the donations in the Indian account after that. But it takes 2 years time to get approval for receiving international money. So for the next 2 years, at least for somebody who is sending us money from abroad, it will be the wise.com.
Hi, Bhante. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, if I may ask, actually, is there anything in the commentary that sheds any light regarding the first course? I know it's supposed to be not explained, so I'm just trying my luck.
Yeah, see, there is nothing in my knowledge in commentaries, but I am not an expert on commentaries. But I'll say that Buddha has said in the suttas in multiple ways. One way he has said is that when he was a bodhisattva and he was looking at his previous lifetimes, he went back as much as he could, but he could not find the first kind of the beginning. And then he went into the future and looked into the future, but he could not go to the future, the end of the future. So he does not, so we don't believe in eternity technically. The time frame which is near eternity, we can say, but not eternity technically. So that is that previous lifetimes when Buddha wanted to kind of find out, he could not find out the beginning. And one other way he explains is that if there are four monks who sit for the seeing of the previous lifetimes, and each day they see 100,000 lifetimes, each monk. And then they stay there doing this task for 100 years. They would have not seen their beginning lifetimes. And I think he takes the example of four monks because one may have a longer kind of life, one may have a shorter beginning or something like that. So as a kind of example, he takes four monks who sit and see 100,000 lifetimes each day. They do it this task for 100 years. So that is how we are kind of given a hint that that is something which should not be attempted. So even if you have 100 years to live,
Bhante, I was thinking that only applies to us because I didn't think that would apply to the Sammasambuddha because I thought this first course thing is could not be understood by any other person other than the Sammasambuddha because I
previous life
believe that the Sammasambuddha could I'm talking about the like you have to go back lifetime by lifetime to search back, but I thought there was one sutta that you know the Buddha said that if he were to think of something, then the knowledge would appear in his mind. Just like he was talking to the prince and he asked the prince, if I were to ask you the different parts of a chariot, would you need to think about it or the thought will just pop up in your mind? So in my understanding, my own personal understanding, I thought if the Buddha were to think that what was the beginning of the ignorance, then his mind, the knowledge will arise in him. He doesn't have to like go back lifetime by lifetime to search for it.
What Buddha says is that whatever is possible to be discerned, that he can kind of discern. So we can say that the origin is something which is undiscernible because that is beyond the kind of scope or beyond his patience or as a bodhisattva, when he was doing this activity of looking at his previous lifetimes to find the beginning, then that time as a bodhisattva, whatever patience he had was exhausted and he could not find it. So then he just left that task. So if there is a knowledge which can be gained, he can gain that knowledge, but he is not omnipresent that he always he has the knowledge. Whatever he can wants to see, he can see, but he is not omniscient. He is not seeing everything all the time. So he has to put his attention towards that and then he will know.
Yeah, so basically that means the Buddha not just thought that he wants to revert back to his mind to the very beginning, and that knowledge will just arise in him rather than having to go through.
No, but he has to go through the process, because that is how it has been explained in the suttas, that when you are wanting to see your past life, it goes in a sequence. So he goes back a lot of time, like he says that asankhyas, then mahakapas, then so many mahakapas, and so many there are kind of units of measurements. So abuddha and all those units of measurements are there. So he went all those time and still he was not. So that is a thing. And then again, what he says in the famous simile of the handful of leaves is that I may have a knowledge which is vast, but I give you a knowledge which is handful of leaves, because that is what is important to us. So what is dukkha and the cessation of dukkha? That is what he is teaching us. And that is what is kind of importance to us in this point of time. So one of the ascetics is trying to ask Buddha about previous lifetimes. So Buddha says that, see, if a person was able to see the previous lifetimes, then I could have discussed with that person about previous lifetimes, and if he has any doubts, I could have clarified it, or I could have asked that person a question and clarified any kind of a doubt the other person had by asking a question. But if you have no kind of access to the past and you don't have any access to the future knowledge, then I teach only what is there in the current time. So this is ignorance, ignorance as condition, sankharas come to be, that is violation of conditions, actions. So those are the things which he teaches in the present. So he always starts out with the dependent origination in such certain situations. So he certain ascetics, he does talk about past lives and he does talk about the future also. But certain ascetics, he starts out with, see, you don't see the past and you don't see the future. I cannot talk to you about that, but I can talk to you about now. And Sati, son of a fisherman, that sutta also, you can see that it, after going through the dependent origination, Buddha says that now, as you know this in this present moment, would you go to the past and try and ask questions about, was I in the past? Was I not in the past? What was I in the past? How was I in the past? What will be I in the future? Will I be in the future? All these questions you will not ask, because you will know in the present whatever has to be known.
Yeah, so, thank you very much, Panti, for the answer.
Okay. Sadhu. So any other questions? Okay, I think everybody has exhausted their questions. So we will share merit, and then we will meet on Sunday. I think Sunday, sister will be okay by that time. And we will meet with the Australian group. I'll share the details. May suffering ones be suffering free, and the fear struck fearless be. May the grieving shed all grief, and may all beings find relief. May all beings share this merit that we have thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. may beings inhabiting space and earth, devas and nagas of mighty power, share this merit of ours. May they long protect the Buddha's dispensations.